This thought brings us to step 10, which suggests we continue to take personal inventory, basically like a mini daily four step, and we continue to set right new mistakes as we go along. We vigorously commence this way of living as we cleaned up the past. I take guys to prayer and meditation when before they're starting on their four step, they're doing 10 and 11 on a daily basis. If you've got this big pile of crap that you've created on your drinking life and from your addiction, let's not create an entire another pile while we're over here, while we're trying to dig this up by doing a fourth and fifth step, because it's going to take some time to dig through a fourth and fifth step. Let's clean the daily stuff up while we work on the ancient history stuff as we go through. So I teach in prayer meditation right out of the get-go. And I've heard people say, well, wait a minute, you can't talk about God with a newcomer, you'll scare him off. Guess what? Alcohol will scare him right back. I'm not worried about that. My job, according to this book, is to lay the spiritual toolkit at their feet. If they want what I have and they're desperate enough to get it, they have the gift of desperation, they'll pick up the spiritual toolkit. If nothing else, I plant the seed. And when they go out there, they can't successfully drink anymore because they know the truth. And eventually, if they live, they'll make it back in here. But I digress. All right? This is not an overnight matter. It should continue for a lifetime. And here comes the next thing. It says, continue to watch for selfishness, dishonesty, resentment, and fear. I've worked with one word in Alcoholics Anonymous for over 20 years, folks. Watch. What does it look like to watch? I'm watching for selfishness, dishonesty, resentment, and fear. It says, when these crop up, it doesn't say if these crop up. They're going to crop up. And if you haven't had a resentment in a week, guess what? You're going through life asleep thinking you're awake. They're there. But we're tremendous at pushing those things down into Pandora's box. If it doesn't peg the meter, we figure, hey, I got it okay. But there's still this low-grade agitation that starts our day, and we're just kind of crabby and, you know, that everybody's shaking their heads. You know the gnawing kind of, you get in your life? Guess what's motivating that? That's fear-based resentment. It's in your life. And it gives us a set of instructions. When these crop up, we ask God. There's another square. We're at our second prayer. We ask God at once to remove them, right? Here comes your instructions. There's four instructions. First piece is we ask God to remove them. We discuss them with someone immediately. Sometimes it's the person that you got upset with. You know, I could be sitting there at 7-Eleven, right? And the person's going too slow. The lady that was in front that wanted to count the change out of her purse. And now I'm in this state of agitation. I've got this little mini resentment. And I'm up and I'm starting to be short with the 7-Eleven clerk. And I'm thinking, come on, I just want that lottery ticket and pay my gas bill. Give me hurry up. And I'm starting to act short, and I can catch myself if I'm watching. And I see myself in that behavior, and that's not the man I want to be today. So I'll stop myself, and I'll go, oh, excuse me, ma'am, I'm sorry. I'm just having a bad day. What did I just do there? I shared it with someone immediately. I shared it with the person I was being mean to. I fulfilled the second requirement. I don't necessarily have to run and get on my phone and call my sponsor and say, you're not going to believe what I just did at 7-Eleven. If I have to, I will, or I'll call anybody that's in this room and say, hey, I just screwed up. Here's what I have to do about it. But anybody, any other human being, I got to get out of you've heard me say it this morning, I got to get out of the itty bitty shitty committee. The voices that are in my head, that's, if I'm thinking about it, I'm behind enemy lines, because on the top of page 23, it says the problem centers in our mind. So guess what, folks? You have to be out of your mind to find God. You cannot think your way through Alcoholics Anonymous or Al-Anon. You have to experience it, and you go through these prayers and meditations to seek power outside of yourself. And the reality is the power is inside of yourself. It's deep down within, and you're just blocked off from it. You got to remove the block, all right? So we ask God at once to remove it, which means a prayer. We discuss it with someone else immediately. We make amends quickly if we've harmed anyone. So I apologize to the 7-Eleven clerk. And then we resolutely turn our thoughts to someone we can help. That's the hard piece. Who can I help? So very often, if I've been that way, I'll look at the 7-Eleven clerk and I'll say, you know, I thought I was having a bad day. How are you doing? Are you okay? I had that experience with the coffee lady over there. She provided me great service, and she gave me a cup of coffee, and she made the correct change, and I gave her a tip in the cup, and I'm filling up my coffee cup, and I looked at her, and she had this weird look in her face. And I listened to the still small voice, and I said, how are you doing today? And she's like, I'm doing fine. Now, I hadn't done anything wrong, so I wasn't doing this particular thing, but I was bothering to pay attention to somebody outside of myself, a very unalcoholic behavior, you know, I mean, normally it's all about us, right? And she says, I'm doing fine. I said, you know, you guys provide us with great service, and if nobody's told you, thank you very much for your service today. This has been a great experience at this hotel. Everybody here has been very professional. Thank you. And you could just see her. She kind of puffed right up, and she says, well, thank you for saying that. I made the world a little better place because I was in it and I was sober today, right? So it's easy to do once you learn how to do this. I just have a lot of experience with this because I screw up a lot. Maybe you guys don't. All right? Then we resolutely turn our thoughts to someone we can help. Love and tolerance of others is our code. That's in a very powerful statement. Love and tolerance of others is our code. Huge, right? There's a whole bunch more of these prayers and meditations. We don't have time to cover them all, but I do want to cover one on page 85. Let's look at the next piece. 85:1. It is easy to let up on the spiritual program of action and rest on our laurels. We are headed for trouble if we do, for alcohol is a subtle foe. We are not cured of alcoholism. What we really have is a daily reprieve contingent on the maintenance of our meetings. No. Maintenance of our talking to our sponsor. No. Maintenance of our spiritual condition. Every day. Wait a minute. Did they just say every day? Every day is a day when we must. Wait a minute. I thought there were no musts in recovery. There's a lot of musts. Every day is a day when we must carry the vision of God's will into all of our activities. Do you think they really meant all of our activities? Yeah, they meant all of our activities. That's the deal. There's the vision, prayer, meditation, and vision. It's right out of the book.